thing, Cullen, who just turns out, as you can see, some of the reason why perhaps, she is one of my all-time favorite humans. And I'm most appreciative of her kind introduction and certainly of BCI's trustees and their special recognition of my role in founding BCI. But more than anything, I want to thank my all-time favorite friends and colleagues, members of NASBR, who have given me this special privilege of speaking to you this morning on one of my favorite topics. As Cullen already explained, back at the time, well, she didn't go back that far, but when we founded NASBR 46 years ago, bats were in a hell of a pickle in terms of public attitudes and perceptions. They were spending literally tens of millions of dollars a year just to have bats poisoned in buildings because they were so frightened of them, believing them to be nothing but disease-ridden vermin that would give them rabies. Since then, we in this group have made a huge amount of progress. We've conducted the research that has shown that bats are indispensably valuable to human well-being. We have spread the word that bats need not be feared. We've preserved literally thousands of bat habitats around the world. And for that, we should take great pride. However, unfortunately, today I have to admit that I pretty much agree with Tom O'Shea and Associates, who recently published a paper warning us that many of America's bats may be on the threshold of non-survival because of the great number of new threats that they're facing. We all know that wind power facilities are growing like mushrooms. They're killing hundreds of thousands of bats annually. Many here in this group have conducted outstanding research to show what needs to be done to protect bats from fatalities at wind sites. But unfortunately, far too seldom have companies actually taken our recommendations seriously and acted upon them. I do have, I think, a good idea that was recently given to me by someone in the financial consulting community who consults on green energy. I was told that if we would just get together with some of the best people in the wind industry, and you know, no matter how negatively we may view an industry overall, there's always someone good in that industry that we can form a beachhead of progress with. We just avoid making examples of the worst so that we have everybody mad at us and we fight them. Find the best and collaborate with them. There are still opportunities to form beachheads of progress. And what we really need to do, I think, is get together some of the most credible of this group and some of the most credible within the industry that care about wildlife and begin ranking companies according to just how green they are. We have to be very carefully quantitative, objective, and obviously fair-minded. If we're not, we lose credibility. But if we just do that, I've been told that green energy investment advisors could take that information and influence investment, even they say if they only influenced it by 5 to 10%, that they could make a very big difference in how corporate America paid attention to bats. I'm hoping someone will soon take that on. Now, of course, we get to white nose syndrome, caused by fungus that recently invaded America. Despite our very best efforts, it has spread like wildfire from coast to coast. At this point, I think it's time to face reality. We're not going to stop it. we're not even going to slow it down. It's going to spread in every habitat and species that it can occupy in America. I don't even believe that there is any way that we're going to find a practically effective method to cure it. It's here. It's time to face it. I think it's time to forget about just going out and trying to document exactly where it's spread and how many bats it's killed. In doing that, oftentimes, we are taking a chance on being the proverbial straw that broke the camel's back. There are too many people going in to hibernation sites in the winter to see how the bats are doing and document what's happening. And every time we do that, we're adding to the burden of stress. These bats are already losing energy because they wake up too often from white nose syndrome. Then we come along to have a look and see what's going on. And the next thing we're doing is possibly causing them to die because we're so concerned. And I know that people going into hibernating sites are all very well intended and they don't mean to be harming the bats. But at this point, since there's nothing we can do to stop this, why don't we start devoting all of our attention to the fact that these tiny remnants of bats desperately need help in recovery. How can we help them recover? First of all, we got to quit being part of their burden going in to see how they're doing in the wintertime. I am encouraged that through all this, we have educated an awful lot of Americans to new appreciation of the importance of bats. Federal and state agencies are now paying much more attention to the fact that just maybe they ought to be keeping track of status trends for all bats, not just a few endangered species. I would like to see a lot more emphasis placed on mechanical devices at cave entrances that could monitor the number of bats going in and coming out instead of going in and disturbing them and adding to their burden. I'd like to see more acoustic monitoring. I believe that there is, you know, no matter how we monitor bat trends, we always are going to have questions about the accuracy of what we're doing. But going in and disturbing them in the wintertime is probably one of the least accurate ways of keeping track of bats in general anyway. Let's try for change, doing a lot better job. I know that a number of you are involved heavily in doing standardized summer surveys. Let's try to perfect that the best we can. And I think there's still a lot of opportunity to keep track of what's going on without adding to the burden. We need to protect these bats every way we can at their roost, summer and winter, particularly in winter. And that brings me to yet another issue that I think is pretty predictable how I've responded to it given my past and having been here 46 years ago when everybody was killing bats. I frankly have been appalled at the frequency with which we've been seeing in recent years just an avalanche of horribly scary articles about bats. This one says, hordes of deadly diseases are lurking in bats and sometimes jumping to people. Can we prevent a major pandemic? Really? Bats are going to cause a major pandemic? The article even goes on to ask if we should kill the bats before their diseases kill us. These things, we can't just ignore. They're having an impact. Now, let's take a look at what's behind some of these things. Nowadays, I can't even look at a good article anymore about the values of bats without seeing it in the introduction saying, because bats are such dangerous sources of Ebola, long list, it's important to know everything we can about them. Well, before we pile all this stuff on bats, let's take a look at just how accurate this quote science is. Did Ebola really come from bats? The whole world knows it did by now. But did it? Okay, let's look at the first major press release sent out by the National Institutes of Health in 2014. Ebola outbreak traced back to toddler fruit bat. A team had gone to the village where the index case was. A child less than 2 years old was the first to die of it. And they examined a lot of bats, found no evidence of the virus in any bats. They examined hunters who killed and ate bats, no evidence of Ebola in them. But somehow they had to figure out before they left who did it, so they pinned it on a less than 2 year old boy. Now, anybody here can tell me how illogical it is that we're going to assume that a 3 foot wingspan bat that never enters human dwellings just happened to infect a 2 year old boy without anybody knowing it. Okay, so a lot of people recognize this as a little bit strange. So they sent another crew back a few months later. Thank you very much. This next crew found that there was actually a roost of free-tailed bats in a tree hollow not far from where the boy lived. They found that teenage boys in the village had been eating these bats. None of them came down with Ebola. They looked at a wide diversity of bat species, found no evidence of Ebola virus in any of them. They failed to look at most other possible options of animals. In fact, they said they didn't look at the other animals significantly because they weren't getting sick. But they said that the reason we had to look at bats is because they didn't get sick and they could be reservoirs. So somebody tell me the logic of that. In the end, they concluded that this 2 year old boy, or nearly 2 year old boy, must have gotten Ebola from the free-tailed bats by playing too near their roost. And in case somebody, each paper clearly says, but don't kill bats, they're highly beneficial. But if you tell somebody rattlesnakes are highly beneficial, which is true, you think they're not going to kill the next one they find in their yard? And in this case, what happened? By the time the second paper was published, in the paper they point out that the locals had already burned the bat roost with all the bats in it. Now, somehow, despite any corroborative evidence, now they decided that this must have come from the free-tailed bats because they were in the vicinity. I'm sure there were dogs and motor scooters and telephone poles in the vicinity. You know, I really take exception to the idea that we can now take spurious, isolated correlations and treat them as causation, ignoring all kinds of other correlations that argue against what we're trying to prove. In fact, the whole deal is trying to prove an hypothesis instead of testing an hypothesis. So now, what finally has come out this year, bat origin now considered unlikely in a review paper. And go to my website, and under resources, you'll find my detailed comments on the reasons why this is very unlikely. But there's no time to go into that detail now. I can tell you, though, that there's very good evidence that Ebola didn't come from bats. Now, speaking of strange National Enquirer type premature headlines, how about when MERS was announced? Bat out of hell, Egyptian tomb bat may harbor MERS virus. Now that's not out of National Enquirer. Notice AAAS published that. One of the world's leading scientific organizations published that kind of a title on a sample of one based on a small fragment of virus found in one bat? In Nature, not to be outdone by science, I mean, God, how could one of us be credible without the other one following? Right after, they come out with their own deadly coronavirus found in bats title. probably they delayed the finding of the source, the real source, by spending too much time looking at bats when they shouldn't have been. Several studies subsequently looked at bats in multiple countries, multiple researchers, and couldn't corroborate these first two headline stories. Finally, as I hope most of us know by now, it was discovered that dromedary camels are the MERS reservoir from which zoonotic transmission occurs. Now, but I guess in every field there are a few diehards that just can't give up proving their hypothesis. So now we've got people out there saying, but the camels must have gotten it somewhere. Now, if we had found the exact same evidence that we have against camels in bats, I am absolutely convinced that these people would have said, case closed, we found the culprits. Would they have said, oh, but the bats must have gotten it somewhere, let's look at camels? Okay, I rest my case. I think it's time that we quit trying to prove hypotheses and start testing hypotheses. This kind of research is a bane on science. It's going to discredit science in general, and certainly it's going to discredit the people who are crying wolf based on such absolutely ludicrous approaches to science. I'm not saying that bats don't transmit anything ever anywhere, but I will tell you that if you take all of the so-called emerging viruses that have been associated with bats, take all of them combined for the last 20 years and you have less than 20,000 human deaths. Figure that as to how big a factor it is in human mortality worldwide. It's incredibly small, but we're making it incredibly big and piling it on the back of bats. Before I go on, I would like to point out that lately, as Rodrigo Medellin pointed out in his plenary speech in Costa Rica, every time we find a new virus in a bat, it gets published as though it were a great discovery and it's related to something deadly. But you know, as Rodrigo pointed out, all life on Earth is related. We can claim anything is related to anything. He pointed out that we're genomically 96% identical to chimpanzees. And how many of us are having trouble discerning between humans and chimpanzees? And yet some of these viruses, if they're 84% related to something dangerous, they get proclaimed as, oh my God, look at here, more evidence that bats can be dangerous. One recent study showed that literally hundreds of new species of virus were found in a single human being. And I didn't hear anybody saying, oh, but these viruses are related to something deadly. So, enough of that rant. Let's go on to what we should be studying. And I'm glad to see the guy who started what I think should be done, Gary McCracken and John Westbrook, did the pioneering research documenting that bats were extremely important in protecting agriculture. Their work has now been heard around the world and is making a huge difference in our understanding of bats and people's perceptions of why they should be protected. Their work, I'm sure, led, in fact, I want to add that it's not just Gary and John Westbrook, but also they were later joined by Tom Kuntz and Rodrigo Medellin and others who worked with Gary. But I still go back to Gary and John as the pioneers in this. Now, in a recent study, I'm sure, based on what they originally did, it was found that just by putting up small, strategically located bat houses in the Mediterranean, they are able to eliminate pesticide used to protect rice crops, just 5 bats per acre were enough to eliminate the need for pesticide use against bats. And then B. Moss looked at what bats were doing for cacao growers in Indonesia, and she and her associates found that bats were saving these growers an estimated $780 million annually. You know, I don't think she's having any employment problems. You find those kind of things, and that's the way to secure your future. We don't need to scare people about what bats might do to us someday when we could be looking at what they are doing for us. As Gary has pointed out, there's no substitute for a good picture of a bat catching an insect when we're trying to convince people of the value of bats. I'm proud to point out that I'm taking my best pictures ever lately, and I took this picture just a matter of a couple months ago in Taiwan. This is a caribou just ready to snatch that moth, and here he is actually eating the moth in flight. It's really critically important that we turn a new leaf in how we're doing these things. Too often we communicate only with our fellow colleagues. It doesn't do any good to do this research and to take these pictures if we don't share them with the world far beyond our immediate colleagues. Peter Taylor, many of you know, invited my wife Paula and me to South Africa recently to photographically document the fact that bats are primary predators of green stink bugs. Using his data, and believe me, we need, when we're doing these kind of studies, let's not get into this proving hypotheses. We want to do good research to back up what we're doing. But his research combined with my photos, and I presented them to the Macadamia Growers Association of South Africa, and immediately they funded not just one PhD project, but two of them to see how they could encourage more bats near macadamia orchards. Communication really pays off. We don't have to just focus on what bats are doing controlling pests. Several years ago, while I was still in charge of Bat Conservation International, this woman, Norma Monfort, was really frightened that she was going to lose her bat colony that her family had protected for generations. The government had just informed them that they were applying to turn this into an agricultural area, which would have meant the end of her bats. She appealed to every major conservation organization she knew of in the world. Not one of them even responded. She finally turned to BCI. Her email came to me. Within a few weeks, Dave Waldeen and I were out on site. We spent a week surveying a dozen caves around that hadn't been protected. And, you know, this is scary stuff. Most of us don't realize. We go to a cave where bats still exist, and we don't go and check to see how many caves have lost their bats. We found that 95 to 100% of the bats had already been lost in the unprotected caves. We came back, presented that data to local community leaders. Incidentally, we estimated 2 million roseate fruit bats in Norman's cave. We came back, presented this information to community leaders, and as I was entertaining them about bats, I just happened to throw in a picture of bats pollinating, these rosettas pollinating durian. Point out that a colony of the size of Norma's could pollinate literally tens of millions of durian flowers in a single night. The durian industry is worth multi-billions of dollars a year in Southeast Asia. You can't produce durians, not even in an orchard, without bats to pollinate the flowers. You think it was really very difficult to get the mayor, here's the mayor sitting between me and Norma, signing a petition, a quickly successful petition to the Philippine government saying, hey, we want these bats protected as critical wildlife habitat. Not only were we quickly successful, but Norma has gone on to establish a visitor center near the cave where today thousands of people a year come to learn about the values of bats. I shudder to think the difference that there could have been had somebody first gotten there that said, but you know, these bats could anytime cause a pandemic that could kill all of us. There's a big difference in the message here, and we've got to be very careful what messages we're giving out. Now, I want to briefly share with you my approach, highlights of my approach to how I win over skeptical audiences to appreciate bats. First, I'm going to show you what I don't recommend doing. What I don't recommend doing is showing snarling bats. That looks okay to us because we're used to seeing, we know the bats aren't really that way, that they're just snarling in self-defense. But, you know, for a little TLC and a bribe, we can have this smile. That's the same bat 3 minutes after offering him a bribe. Now, I like to, in my presentations, start out by confusing people. These people that don't like bats, they think they already know all there is. They're ugly, they're dangerous, they're blah, 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 blah. Okay, show them a few pictures of bats. They're so strikingly different than anything they ever imagined that they have to immediately realize they must have been confused and ignorant for a long time. So I start out with something like this yellow bat, painted bat, snow white, ghost bat. In fact, Carlos, I think, is in the audience. He helped me take this picture. Show them these kind of things. Then I also point out one more thing early on, and that is that despite all the scary things we've heard about bats and disease, bats, in fact, have easily demonstrable one of the finest track records on our planet of living safely with people, as illustrated in Austin, Texas. When those 1.5 million bats began moving into newly created crevices under our Congress Avenue Bridge, health officials warned that they were carrying all kinds of diseases, rabid, and would attack people. People panicked, wanted the bats eradicated. I moved back Conservation International to Austin thinking this was a perfect opportunity to educate the world about the positive value of living with bats. So what's happened? All we did was told the city to put up small signs warning people not to handle the bats. And more than 35 years later, we are still waiting for the first human to contract a disease or be attacked. And yet, take a look at the close association. Millions of people have stood on that bridge within feet of those bats. And I don't usually talk about this, but the people who are down here below get a rain of strange things. And none of them have gotten sick. The people of Austin now know from experience that bats make safe, invaluable neighbors, that the bats are eating literally tons of crop and yard pests a night, that they are bringing in millions of tourist dollars a summer. They love their bats. That's been the history where people have had a chance to live with bats that they understood. Next, of course, people think bats are all ugly. All they've seen is those ugly, snarling pictures in many cases, or it used to be. They think they're ugly. So I like to show them that bats can be just as attractive as any other animals. In fact, these four handsome dudes, I point out, are the most widespread species of America. And yes, there are really sophisticated bats. They're just as incredibly fascinating as any dinosaur. Present that to kids, you show them that picture just out of the blue, and they'll, oh, isn't he ugly? Ask them if they like dinosaurs first, and say, now I got a bat that is just as neat as any dinosaur you ever saw, and they'll say, oh, isn't he great? There's a lot of difference in how we present things. But just in case somebody doesn't like dinosaur bats, I've always got a jolly good fellow. I go on to point out that bats are incredibly sophisticated, that they can actually hear the faint footsteps of a walking insect, that bats can actually, on the darkest night, in dense foliage, pluck a sleeping caterpillar off a leaf, that some bats have special adhesive discs on their wrists and ankles that enable them to cling to the slick inner surface of unfurling leaves where they live, that other bats have flattened skulls that enable them to quickly enter and exit tiny beetle holes in bamboo. And believe it or not, and talk about opportunities to make great discoveries. I mean, there have been discoveries made just in the last couple of years that just blow my mind. They're great. Who would have ever thought that there was a species of bat that lived in pitcher plants, which are famous for eating anything that enters, including rats? And here we've got a bat that's figured out how to live in an animal-eating plant. People also tend to be interested in sex and courtship. So it's not a bad idea to tell them a little bit about bat courtship. I won't go into it. I think most of you know that these epaulette bats have inflatable cheek pouches to enhance their song and dance. They have pouches in their shoulders from which they can flash big white epaulets as they do this. It's all pretty cool. Now, for those of you here who are younger, just deciding on a career and what you might want to do research on, let me point out, we've just been through an incredible diversity of bats. The world of bats is full of amazing research opportunities. Most bats, most of more than 1,300 species of bats worldwide, have yet to be studied significantly beyond simply being taxonomically described. I can't think of a more wide open field with new technology developing every day that opens new doors that were never before available, as long as bats have been neglected and as many as there are in the diversity. And there are huge opportunities to show what bats do for us. In closing, I want to tell you about one of my favorite bat conservation, bat research stories, Peapod here. We'll be familiar with this one. Late in 1981, I was asked by Buddhist monks in Thailand to help them figure out why their guano production of Khao Chom Phraya Cave was precipitously declining. Didn't take long to figure out that the decline was coming from poachers, who every night when the monks went to bed, sneaked in with their big nets, covered the entrance of the cave, were catching huge numbers of bats and selling them for restaurant trade. I advised the monks that they would simply hire a game warden. The cost of that game warden's salary would be insignificant compared to the increased revenue they would get from guano sales. Sure enough, I came back 9 years later, and guano sales had risen from $12,500 US dollars a year to $89,000 And a few years later, I believe it was Tiga, I saw in one of her papers citing that it had risen to $132,000 a year. $132,000 a year from $12,500 just from hiring a game warden, they probably didn't pay $1,000 a year to. As the bat numbers became ever more impressive, a group who I'm sure were stimulated initially by Gary's pioneering work decided to see what free-tailed bats might be worth agriculturally in Thailand. And as in Gary's work, they just looked at one of a whole group of species that these bats fed on. But in looking just at white-bellied plant hoppers, they found that these bats were saving local rice growers an estimated $300,000 a year. That's on top of $132,000 a year made in selling guano for fertilizer. As the bat numbers increased, the columns of emerging bats would be visible literally for miles around. I don't know who really has the biggest bat population in the world, but I'll tell you one thing, you can't see anything better than this. It's actually more regularly spectacular than bracken. So thousands of people now come from all over to see the bats, and naturally the local people are enterprising and they capitalize on these tourists. I think by now I've made my case. Bats contribute enormously to the well-being of people. There are huge opportunities to document that, and there are just enormous opportunities if we will just focus on what bats do for us instead of what they might someday do to us. If we share this entertainingly with the broad public beyond our colleagues, the odds of dramatic improvement in conservation, not to mention improved funding for our own research efforts, are enormous. Thank you very much.
We've got microphones in the back so that wait for your question and you can speak into the microphone so the group can hear you.
While we're waiting to get to the questions, let me point out that this new organization I founded that Pelton mentioned is not intended to compete with existing organizations. I have absolutely no interest in founding another big organization. What I'm doing is providing resources that are invaluable for people who want to promote conservation but are not available elsewhere. You can now, today, go to this website, MerlinTuttle.org, and download almost any picture that you just saw. There are nearly 2,000 pictures, and soon will be 2,000 pictures available of more than 250 some species of bats worldwide, doing anything you want to show. So there's no excuse for saying, well, I just don't have Merlin Tuttle's pictures, so I can't do this. And if you want more detail on what I think about some of the research on disease, go to our resource section and look under
Test.
We in this room love bats, but how do you convince governments that it's worthwhile funding wildlife work? Because it seems like money is pulled more and more away into other things.
Well, you know, the really sad part of this, as a virologist just wrote me 2 days ago, people seem to just love to be scared of trivial things, and governments love to take advantage of that. We've got to find a way to make them more interested in what bats do for us than what they might do to us. And that's not necessarily easy, but not to brag, but let me point out that in my personal career, which extends back for more than 50 years, I have never once gone for an NSF grant. I have never once gone for a major foundation grant. I have raised tens of millions of dollars, not just for my research, but for conservation of bats, which everybody thought was impossible. It can be done. The key is we have to become good entertainers who communicate well. I was amazed years ago when I worked on Morrow, Colorado Island, that how many scientists would totally poo-poo the idea of even having an article in National Geographic that, you know, this wasn't real science, this was waste time. As long as we want to live in our ivory towers and communicate only with our fellow converts, we're not going to get very far. But the public decides on how NSF is funded and how much money they get. We start communicating adequately to the right people, and I do have a rule. I don't just go out and talk to any group. I'm selective. I try to talk to groups that are going to have the most influence, either because of their numbers or because of their decision-making power. And if we're careful and we learn to become good entertainers, you know, even back when I was doing froggy and bat research, I never had one time somebody come up and ask me, but what is this, why is this of any importance to people? It was very esoteric research. Why didn't anybody ask, but how is this value to people? Because people value entertainment more than anything else, and I can entertain them royally with frog eating bats. If we learn to entertain people, not just lecture people, and again, that's part of why I'm doing what I'm doing, making my pictures available. I want to help all of you to become good entertainers, and you're going to find out that that makes the difference in whether you get funded or not. Sorry for such a long response to one short question.
So, how do you make something a destination for tourists and still actually protect? I didn't have a good answer for that.
As briefly as I can, and I'm not known for brevity. Let me respond. First of all, most of us get too emotional when we see people doing horrible things to the bats we love. We've got to go in and first just ask them why they're doing what they're doing, and usually they don't have a really good excuse. Then we can start saying, well, in my experience, you know, actually, for example, in the state of Florida, they're buying and putting up expensive bat houses all over the place in parks as tourist attractions. It's doing very well. Point out the number of places where parks and others, you know, like when we found out that bats could become a great asset under bridges, I had the head bridge designer of the state of Texas, when somebody would call from Arizona and say, we can't get the highway department to cooperate in building bat habitat into bridges, I'd say, call the Texas Department of Transportation, ask them their experience with having bat habitat in bridges. And we'd often change their minds very quickly. It starts with being careful not to get them upset because we don't like what they're doing, but rather just to, we're there to ask questions to understand why they're concerned, and then to help them solve their concerns and show them a better way from our experience. And that has worked very, very well for me.
We have time for one more question if there's one. Rachel.
So how can we influence policy change? So for example, in agriculture, we have the farm bill, which is big. And I would really like to see policy changes within those organizations. But what could be the process there?
Well, first of all, find people who have influence. I've done this in, like when I was in Milwaukee, I got pesticide use against bats outlawed in the state. And believe it or not, the head of the public protection agency was supposed to protect us all from bad policies. They came out and vociferously opposed stopping killing bats. We had to have pesticides to kill bats in buildings because they were going to run rampant if we didn't use them. We organized, went out and found donor groups that provided major political support to the men in the state Senate that were going to vote on our bill. We got a Republican and Democrat to co-sponsor. And when they tried to knock us down, we beat them soundly because the guys voting in the committee knew that key donors to their campaigns loved bats and wanted to see this changed. There's always a way to get to politicians down the line somewhere, and it starts really with their constituency and who votes for them. And if you go out and give the right programs to the right people, tell them what needs to be done, tell them to contact their representatives, you'd be amazed at the difference you can make. In that case, it looked like there was just no hope with the Department of Consumer Protection actually opposing us, and yet we won by a landslide vote, both Democrats and Republicans voting, because we did our homework with the people that they knew were going to vote for or against them in the next election. It takes sometimes some, you know, real hard work, but we can make these things happen.
Thank you, Merlin.
Thank you.